I don't know how it was for you, but the Missing No glitch in Pokemon Red or Blue was incredible to me as a child. Imagine, as a child, you explore this Pokemon world normally, and then in school, another kid tells you about a dangerous Pokemon which multiplies your items. That sounds weird. You first have to talk to this old man. This old man is one of the first characters you talk to in the game, and you probably never talk to him afterwards, but he can explain to you how to catch a Pokemon. And then afterwards, you have to fly to Cinnabar Island. Alright, then you walk all the way to the right, get on your Pokemon and surf along the coast up and down. And suddenly, a very weird Pokemon appears. MissingNo. Your game looks kinda weird, very scary as a child. You flee. And when you look at your items, mysteriously, the sixth item looks glitched and actually this item multiplied to over 100. It's such a beautiful glitch because it fits so well into the game's narrative. It doesn't feel like a mistake or a bug. It doesn't break your immersion as a child and rip you out of the game's world, how many other bugs do. It added to the game. It gave it depth and even more mystery. A sense that there's much more to explore. For many, MissingNo has become a real Pokemon that is part of the Pokemon universe. So, let's explore it. When I play around with stuff like this, I always wonder how did people discover it, because I wonder if I could have found it myself. I use this as a method of learning, instead of just looking at excellent write-ups that already exist on this bug and making just another video that is basically the same, I want to approach it with a more research mindset. Be explorative and invent a story how one could have figured that out. I think this way you get a much better understanding as well as learn more general skills you can apply elsewhere. So let's start. What could have been step one in discovering MissingNo? Imagine you play Pokemon and you want to fill up your Pokedex, and so you look for some Mankeys. Or maybe you hunt for another Pokemon in this area. And then you are done and you decide to catch some water Pokemon next. So you fly down to this island. You decide to surf, but stay at the coast because you want to walk onto the safe land anytime. You are not there for fighting or exploring, you just want to chill and find some Pokemons to catch. And suddenly, a Mankey shows up. What? How does that make sense? You are in the water. You are confused and tell your more intelligent friend about it. Your intelligent friend is a nerd and is very analytical about it. So without knowing anything about the inner workings, you can find out two important behaviors. First, you could notice that it only happens right here on the right coast. Even here at the corner piece, typical water Pokemon show up. And one tile over, if you swim here, also water Pokemon. As soon as you return to the coast piece, the weird Pokemon show up again. You also told your friend you were hunting for Mankeys, and suddenly a Mankey was showing up in the water, which could be an indication that the Pokemon that shows up here depend on what you were looking at before. To play around with this, you travel to different regions and look at the Pokemons you could get here, for example a Kakuna. After that you fly to the island, you surf, and suddenly a Kakuna shows up. So now we know, it only affects this coastline and the Pokemon that show up depend on where you were before. Now, even bigger nerds were wondering, wait, if it shows the Pokemon from where I was before, what does that mean for weird places like the Safari Zone? When you went to the Safari Zone and got annoyed and can't catch the Pokemons you wanted with the limited steps and weird capture system, you throw a rock at the Pokemon, then you leave and you fly to the island. And suddenly, those Pokemon show up here as well. And now it's easier to catch them. That's interesting, right? Now, I was actually wondering, what happens if you go to the Pokemon Tower? Because there are these unidentified ghosts if you haven't completed a certain quest. This is not a real Pokemon, so could we use the island to catch these ghosts? Fly back to the island, surf, and? No, we see Ghastly. The unidentified ghosts are actually Ghastlies and other ghost Pokemons, but you only see those when you get the Sylph Scope item. Or, now we know, you come to the Magic Island and surf here. So still, the Pokemon that show up depend on regions you were before. Now, it doesn't seem too far-fetched to experiment more with it. Find exactly what actions cause certain Pokemon to show up and what doesn't. For example, you could check what happens when you fight a trainer and then fly away, what happens when you were in the water area before, or what happens when you talk to the old man. And this could very well be the story on how the first missing no was discovered, and magically you would see your items multiply. Even though this bug seems so obscure, it seems realistic to just be found by accident in some analytical research mindset. Fine. But how could one figure out what goes wrong under the hood? What happens in memory that this is the result? Like I said, there are many explanations of this already online, but I want to approach this differently. How could we figure out this by ourselves? So I thought, getting the Pokemon capture tutorial by the old man has to write to certain memory, which is then later read when we surf on the island. Talking to the old man changes something so that MissingNo shows up. So this conversation has to write something, and then later we read that when the Pokemon shows up. And memory reads and writes is something we could analyze. So I went into the emulator source code and added some new functionality. The source code of the Game Boy emulator is very clean to me, it was really not hard. First I found here the list of commands available in the debugger console and added my own ones. Trace read, trace write, trace clear, and trace dump. I then copied the function definitions from an existing command and renamed it to mine. These commands are pretty simple. For example, in trace write, we simply toggle a boolean if we have write tracing enabled or not. And then in the memory class where the Game Boy reads and writes are being executed, I added a check that if write tracing is enabled, it will write the value that was written to this memory array. The Game Boy's memory is so small that we can easily track the whole memory in a single array. I basically do the same for reading data as well. When that is enabled, we track the values read in the memory trace area. And also for printing, I'm tracking the ignore array. If we printed this address once, we don't print it anymore, just so we don't spam the output. The trace dump command then writes the whole memory trace array into a file. So let's do this. Let's go to the old man, and just before the tutorial starts, we enable the write tracing. Trace write. You can see now the Game Boy is writing tons of data in different addresses. We go through the whole tutorial, see a lot of writes happening, and at the end we disable the write trace again. We know from experimenting before that one of these writes must have caused that MissingNo will show up on the island. So let's dump all the memory written with trace dump into a write.bin file. This binary file contains now a memory snapshot of all the values and addresses being written to. And then we can also clear and reset the trace. Now, let's fly to the island. We go to the right and surf. We can assume that to choose which encounter to show, it probably reads from a certain memory address this information. So let's enable trace read to track all the reads. Again, we see tons of activity, a lot of memory being read. Okay. Pokemon appeared. At this point, it must have done the important read. It's decided which Pokemon shows up. So we can disable the read tracer and dump the file trace into a read.bin. Cool. So let's analyze this. We have a file containing all the writes, and we have a file containing all the reads. The old man must have written something which we later read on the island. And if we overlay these memories, we can identify all the addresses where this is the case. So let's write a simple Python program. We can open the read and write binary file and then go through all the addresses and compare them. The old man wrote something and the island surfing read something. And that should be the case. If memory changed between these two, it's probably not the memory address we are interested in. So we only want to print all addresses and values where read and write was the same data. And also not zero because everything is zero by default. We assume it must have written some kind of value. When we run this, we get quite a few possible locations, but it's still quite a lot. But when we did the tracing, we noticed a lot of reads and writes that were obviously unrelated, stuff that just happens in the background. And from experimenting earlier, we know that simple walking around and talking to people doesn't affect if MissingNo shows up or not. So we can do another write trace. And we do all the actions in game that should have no effect on us. We walk around, talk to people, look at our menu, we even fly. Once we are satisfied with the writes and we don't see many new writes happening, we can be sure that we must have captured all the important writes that should have no impact on MissingNo. So we can dump this as an ignore.bin. Let's extend our Python code by including this additional information. We open ignore bin, read it as well, and add it to our comparison. We want C to be 0. This means we go through all the addresses where the old man writes to an address, that's B, and the surfing reads from that address, that's A, and when we did any kind of other actions, it didn't touch our address, it didn't write to it. Then we print it. Let's run it. Only 3 values are left. Awesome. Let's look at them more closely. We can patch the emulator again to print whenever a write occurs to these addresses. Let's play the game and observe when this happens. Okay, we got some initial writes when we loaded into the game, but let's ignore that. Let's see what happens during gameplay. Let's fly, go into a house, walking around. It doesn't change anything. That's what we expect. And talking to another person also doesn't do anything. Let's talk to the old man again. There, when the battle starts, it wrote a hex 50 to CFE4. Interesting. Oh, and when the tutorial started, it wrote 2 more values, hex 92 to D888 and hex 87 to D889. And right when the Pokemon got caught, it wrote again hex 50 to CFE4. Let's fly to the island. We go to the water and surf again. Let's go for an encounter there. That caused another write to CFE4 with 50. This doesn't really make sense. We would not expect this value to get written. It's the same value as before anyway. And it got written for the old man and here when the battle started. So it's more likely to have something to do with a battle starting and not what makes MissingNo or other Pokemon to show up. So let's pay more attention to the other values. For example, we can notice that when we walk past the old man into the zone, we see a hex 3 and hex A5 being written to these addresses. And when we get the tutorial again, we see that 92 and 87 is written there again. We can also go somewhere else, a different town. Hasn't changed yet, but as soon as we walk out into the zone, the values update again, hex 6 and hex 24. It seems to write there some information every time when we enter a zone where Pokemon could show up. Not in cities, only when we enter zones with Pokemons. And weirdly, it's written by the old man too. So let's go back to the old man and open the proper memory view to get a better look on the values around it. Here's the hex 6 and hex 24. So let's talk to the old man and keep an eye on here. Boom, there we go. Data was written to it. In fact, it wrote more than 2 bytes that we knew about. It wrote 1 byte earlier, hex 80, hex 92, hex 87, 50, and then zeros. Do you notice something? If you have seen my last video about the save game structure of Pokemon, you might remember that hex 80 is a special value. It could mean the character capital A. So if we assume that these are characters, we can decode them. This is an A. This is hex 92, the A starts at 80, so the difference is hex 12, which means in decimals 18 characters, 0 is the A, so the 19th character is an S. And the last one then should be an H, Ash. In this case, this is the name of our player. Our player name was written to this address. So let's summarize what we learned. We found out that somehow the Pokemons you found in grass somewhere else show up when you directly fly to the island and surf along the coast. It doesn't seem to affect water Pokemon. You can swim here, find water Pokemon, move back to the shore and you get the other ones again. Which means that water and non-water Pokemons, so Pokemons you can find in grass, for example, seem to be handled differently. We also notice that as soon as we enter a zone where there is grass and where we could find Pokemon, it updates this address here. This address is read when we encounter Pokemon at the shore. It seems like it writes here information about the kind of Pokemons you can find and is not reset when you travel or walk around cities, only when you enter zones. And for whatever reason, non-water Pokemons show up on the shore tile, and because it was not reset, the old ones showed up. Which seems fun for the Pokemon Tower or the Safari Zone Pokemon, but for some reason, the tutorial of the old man writes our player's name exactly into that spot. it seems like. It had to reuse some memory, and this memory seemed safe because as soon as you keep walking into the zone, the name is overwritten with the correct data again. But there was this edge case with the buggy shoreline. Cool. We figured out where the information is stored on what kind of Pokemon can show up. Now that we know that, we can also play around with it a bit more. Let's overwrite the data with some recognizable data. Simply 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so forth. Now let's see what kind of Pokemon show up. A Nidoran, level 2. A Lickitung, level 10. An Ivysaur, level 8. A Nidoking, level 6. Huh. All powers of 2. And coincidentally, exactly the values we entered. 2, 6, 8, 10. If we keep looking, we can even find a Spearow, level 4. So it seems like every second value is the level of the Pokemon that can show up, and so maybe the other number is which Pokemon shows up. So let's check that. Let's change them all to ID 1. Now always the same Pokemon should show up, just different levels. And when we do that, yes, that's the case. Raidon level 0, Raidon level 10, Raidon level 12. So internally, the Pokemon with the ID 1 seems to be Raidon. Another test we can do is set all this data to 0 to better see what it is updated. And we can for example see that when we head into the water, the data that is updated is just below this data. So this should be the water Pokemon information and this the on land Pokemon encounter information. So there seems to be a programming bug that on this short tile, land Pokemon show up using this data here, instead of, like the other water tiles, using the water Pokemon information. Also, it should be clear that this game only has 151 Pokemon, but in a byte you can address 256, so it makes sense that something weird should show up if you try to set an encounter Pokemon ID that is not mapped to an actual Pokemon. And when you write the values, like in the name Ash, along with the 0 bytes being written, it is very likely you get some invalid ID and missing no shows up. That's really cool, we just learned a lot. Unfortunately, we still haven't figured out how and why the 6th item is multiplied when you encounter missing no. But I think we have understood the foundation of this bug pretty well, and we can build from that next video. Quick reminder, I'm working on this series with Stack Smashing, so go check out his channel to find more Pokemon and Game Boy hacks or other kind of awesome technical content.